Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 7967 in the name of Alexander Stewart on healthy ageing in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Alexander Stewart to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to bring this debate to the Chamber this evening. And I'd also like to thank members who supported today's motion highlighting healthy ageing in Scotland study, which was led by the University of Stirling, which focuses on real-life day-to-day experiences of older people in Scotland. This is an important issue for many across the Chamber, and I have no doubt that we'll hear some thoughtful contributions, Presiding Officer. It is clear that this issue will only become more important in Scotland in years to come. As we know, there are already over 2 million people aged over 50 in Scotland, which equates to around 38% of the population. We also know that Scotland's population has been steadily ageing for the last 40 years, a trend which will continue. Indeed, the study highlights there will be around 85% of an increase of over 75-year-olds by 2039, which is a higher increase than expected in any other part of the United Kingdom. The study provides first-hand details and insight into the over-50s within Scotland, and its aims to look at older people's health, their economic circumstances, and their social well-being. It is also Scotland's entry to the Gateway to Global Ageing Platform, which provides data for over two-thirds of the world's over-50s population. We've already heard a number of helpful reports have come out from this, and it's looked at specifically focused on the pandemic affected the well-being of older people. The study highlights that broadly the pandemic affected older people's well-being at a time, and we know that older people are still dependent on that recovery, even in today, Presiding Officer. The truth is that well-being of older people in Scotland was a problem well before the pandemic arrived. Data from the National Records in Scotland show that Scotland still has a lower life expectancy, not just in the UK, but across Western Europe. And that is quite damning, Presiding Officer, and I look forward to hearing what the Minister has to say in the summing up with reference to that. While over life expectancy remains low, there are also huge gaps in life expectancy between the most deprived and the least deprived areas of the country. And as far as the population is concerned, the gap for men is about 13 years and the gap for women is 10 and a half years. These are worrying trends, and that worrying trend continues to widen. We also know that there are public health issues with reference to smoking, alcohol and cancer rates, and they all play a part in the process, Presiding Officer. Mental health and loneliness is also a significant problem in Scotland, with over half older people identifying as sometimes feeling lonely. It's also estimated that at least one chronically lonely person exists in every street in Scotland. That is at a crisis, Presiding Officer. With over 150,000 pensioners living in relative poverty, it is virtually impossible and important that the government looks at and considers what older people are dealing with when it comes to their expansion when they talk about social security programmes. Older people are more likely to have a higher level of disability, but a significant percentage are not claiming the disability benefits that they may be entitled to. We cannot allow older people to be left behind from not receiving the support and financial support they require. The government and the Scottish Government needs to do more to address this area. They must also engage both with older people and stakeholders, including Age Scotland, when they talk about developing their benefit take-up strategy. And of course, the waiting lists for older people now faced in the NHS is at a tipping point and is spiralling out of control across many health board areas. It is also the fact that the new health secretary should scrap his predecessor's failed recovery plan to bring in new measures that will get waiting times back on track. That's vitally important. Given all the problems that we have, the Scottish Government must make a clear message that it needs older people and they should be seen as a key priority going forward, Presiding Officer. The First Minister yesterday gave many priorities, but he didn't specifically mention anything with reference to the ageing population we have and anything with older people. And having given that, we used to have a dedicated minister who looked after the older people. That, I know, hasn't been incorporated into other remits. That, I feel, is something that should have not taken place and, in my view, is a fault and a flaw within this new government setup. And that's not to mention that previously comments have been made by a member of the government suggesting that older people passing away since 2014 is a gain for independence. That comment was made, presiding officer, which is an astonishing comment to be made by anybody when we're talking about older individuals in our community. After comments such as that, it's perhaps not surprising that research by Age Scotland has found that just 21% of over 50s in Scotland feel that they are not valued by society. So in conclusion, presiding officer, while the study is a work in progress, it is already clear that the findings we see increasingly important for years to come. The University of Stirling and its partners, including universities in Edinburgh and Strathclyde, should be commended for the work they've done so far. Scotland could truly be a great country in which to grow old, and the findings of the study were a key in making that the vision a reality, presiding officer. But there has to be support from government. There has to be understanding. And it's clear that further action from the Scottish Government in this area is needed. And I hope members from across the chamber can join me in pushing this for the years to come. Older people are important. Older people are valued. And the Scottish Government needs to assist, support and treat older people with the respect they deserve. They are an asset to our communities and our constituencies, not a liability to Scotland and the future. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Could I remind those members who are seeking to speak in the debate to ensure that their request to speak buttons are pressed? Thank you. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and technology is working for me. I congratulate the member on securing this debate and the University of Stirling, which has a proven track record on issues regarding the elderly. Deputy Presiding Officer, I declare an interest, having entered this Parliament in 1999 already, according to this definition of ageing. I was elderly and I was only 55. I'm now, of course, on track to be 79, too soon for my liking. Where did all those decades go? Thank you, Mr. Whittle. So the first comment I would make is that not only are we, those aged in quotes, all individuals, we represent a substantial age range spanning five decades, so one can't generalise. The challenges of ageing are not only physical, I know that, but as the motion states, it is cognitive and social. I'd expand this to include isolation and loneliness, referred to by Alexander Stewart, who is very young. So we have the research, but what can we as politicians, indeed as individuals, do? Generally, and I say generally, we are reasonably well catered for in health. Vaccinations are regular, for example. But it's when we may be unable to care for ourselves, it is then we are vulnerable, especially if we do not have savings or a decent pension. That is why reform of the care sector and support for the workforce must be a priority. Too many languish in hospital when with aids and adaptations to their home, care support at home, or indeed access to a care home, it not only would free up the beds and the staff servicing those beds, but keep people hale and hearty. Mental well-being as well as physical well-being can soon disintegrate when you're stuck in a bed far from your home when that's where you should be. Integrated joint boards was a first step, but we do need cohesion between the NHS and the care sector. Then there is the plague of isolation and loneliness. There are folk whose trip to the local shop or the supermarket is the only social interaction they have. Travelling on the bus with the pass is a bonus because it may be your only social life. The phone is silent unless it's a cold call. The front door remains locked, even in daytime, because there's no one coming to visit. And many will not admit that they are lonely or have only the television or the radio for companionship. But retirement need not be absolute. For some, continuing to work whole or part-time, if compatible with the demands of the job, is a choice. And I note that with the diminishing workforce, many elderly people are turning to work, but it should be a choice and not to prop up, for example, a poor state pension. And of course, 40% entitled to pension credit, a UK benefit, do not claim, and that percentage has remained unchanged in my entire time in this Parliament. But for many, especially very elderly people, there is that sense of being invisible, of melting into the background. Confidence erodes, a sense of self-worth, of value. It need not be like this. As a society, older people are too often regarded as a burden, patronised, not given the respect which, frankly, age has earned. I can also report that age discrimination is alive and well, even in this building. Remember, we were young once too. We recognise the path the young are treading as we trod it before them. But perhaps only with age do we appreciate time, because it's not on our side. In conclusion, there are other cultures which value their elders, and we should do more of that in Scotland. And I can assure you, I will make sure the Scottish Government doesn't ignore us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. And I call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Carol Morgan. Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to my colleague Alexander Stewart for bringing this important matter to the Chamber this evening for debate. He's worked incredibly hard to provide a voice for older people in the Scottish Parliament, although I know his youthful complexion may lead to some of us finding it hard to believe, and the same would go for my constituency neighbour, Christine Graham. Disappointingly, I do struggle to recall the last time we were able to debate a matter relating to older people in this chamber. There is no question that the issue of healthy ageing is a key challenge that we face in Scotland today. Yet, less than holding a debate on the matter, the First Minister failed to mention our ageing population in his statement on Scotland's priorities yesterday. And older people will be frustrated by this. They will also be frustrated by the fact that the Scottish Government have dropped the ministerial portfolio for older people. I would add that the SNP may have dropped this portfolio, but the shadow ministerial team in Alexander Stewart has no such plans to drop this important subject. This valued group has been subject to a catalogue of many letdowns, which Alexander Stewart has already alluded to, particularly the lower life expectancy, particularly in deprived areas. We can and we must do better. Doing better in this context means looking at the evidence is available to us to drive change, and referencing the University of Stirling's Healthy Ageing in Scotland study will provide us with the opportunity to do that and to use it to good effect. It is by no means the only source of evidence we can use to drive change for Scotland's ageing population. We cannot hope to cope with the demands of an ageing population without utilising the findings of this study and the work done by other nations to develop best practice. One example of where this is being done very well is in my constituency in the Scottish Borders, where earlier this year Scottish Borders Council endorsed plans to build a Dutch-style care village. And this scheme is very much part of a shake-up of care provision in the region and a good demonstration of a proactive, action within the local authority to look at those evidence-based practices that can make a real difference for older people and encourage healthy ageing, but also to combat social isolation, as Christine Graham has quite rightly pointed out. It's one of the main issues of poor health outcomes is social isolation, and I completely agree that we should be combating that, particularly through areas such as the Dutch-style retirement village. And we want to move away from institutionalised care and place residents in a neighbourhood because they are closer to broader society. Similar schemes in the Netherlands have found that this, as I said, helps tackle loneliness, improves outdoor access, which are key factors in healthy ageing. I'm delighted that our Conservative-run administration in the Borders is leading the way in finding an innovative solution to cope with the challenges of an ageing population and indeed social isolation. I would encourage the Scottish Government to take note of this and join them in this thinking outside of the box when it comes to dealing with these challenges. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would like to reiterate the importance of having this discussion tonight in Parliament. The message sent by the Scottish Government in dispensing with the ministerial portfolio for older people is deeply concerning. But as long as we have the opportunity in here to speak up for older people and continue to do that, then we can be their voice in this place. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I now call Carol Mockin to be followed by Brian Whittle. Ms Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also thank Alexander Stewart for bringing this important debate to the Chamber, and thank all the members for really highlighting how important a group this is and that we should be having debates, making sure that we are addressing the issues for the older population. On behalf of Scottish Labour, can I too welcome the Healthy Ageing in Scotland study led by the University of Stirling and put on record my thanks to the team who will start the extremely important work. It is important to know at the start of my contribution that although this study is the first of its kind and will look at many different factors including health, social and economic circumstances, the main aim set out by the team of researchers is a simple but critical one: to improve the health and well-being of Scotland's older people by fully understanding their lives. The health of our population must be the priority for any Parliament and any government, and that is clearer now after the last few years perhaps than it ever has been so before. However, to be healthy does not just mean to be physically healthy, as other members have stated, but to be mentally healthy, socially healthy, and economically healthy. Each of these crucial aspects of life all play a role in determining the health and outcomes of an individual, a family, or a population. The motion correctly notes that our older population is growing and people are living longer, but is also right to state that significant and divisive income inequality exists in our society today. And I might say to Alexander Stewart that I absolutely agree with much of the content of the motion and the words that he's brought forward. And I know that Alexander Stewart has been a champion of older people. But in my view, and I have to say this, it's important, it is the policies of his own party that is responsible for much of this division. And we do need to see a whole change approach in regards to improving pay, closing pay gaps, and supporting the lowest paid to improve health and wellbeing outcomes later in life. It starts early in life and it continues. People start an unhealthy life and they live an unhealthy life. And a lot of that is linked to the austerity that we see in this country. Indeed, Presiding Officer, I think it is important that we touch on health inequalities right now. In my view, it is my view that health inequalities are one of the greatest strains in our society, and members will not be surprised to hear me say that. I say it often. An action, far greater action than we've had, needs to happen. The First Minister yesterday rightly focused on tackling poverty, but in this country we see those from deprived areas less likely to attend screening appointments, and that remains a stark gap and an unavoidable gap. That is not always just about income, it's about how we make sure those people can attend those really vital screening appointments. We know that health inequality exists from birth, but we also know that it continues to negatively impact throughout people's lives and can determine outcomes in later life. As the project embarks on this study, it will be interesting to see if we as parliamentarians can act more decisively and more effectively to address these issues that ultimately have led to the study of this kind being undertaken. A staple of any healthy, progressive, modern nation should be the ability of its citizens to age healthily and to grow old with dignity, and hopefully this study will allow future improvements to be made to positively impact the health and well-being of the older population. In concluding, Presiding Officer, many of the challenges facing our older people in Scotland today have been challenges exacerbated by poor government decisions. In some cases, governments just have inaction. We know that we need to improve the health and well-being of our population if we want to improve the health and well-being of our elderly population, and we need to be quite radical and have some urgency about this. Healthy ageing should be a priority. Can I once again thank Alexander Stewart for bringing the motion and to all the members for contributing to the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I now call Brian Whittle, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And it had been my intention to come along today and just listen to what has to be said, given my advancing years, apparently, according to what old is. But I happened to take part today in a webinar on a university report that looked at the life expectancy around elite sports people. And it turned into a more of a discussion around, you know, early years and attitude. Now, you'll be pleased to hear, Presiding Officer, that I can expect to live an extra 5 years according to this report. But what was more important than that, I think the sportsmen and women that were on that call really looked more at the reason that we would live longer. It's not necessarily because of the excessive physical activity we did in our younger years, but more about the attitude that's ingrained into a sports person's mind. And it's not a big leap to think that, you know, we know that being physically active has a positive influence on our life expectancy in later years. It's not a big leap to think that, you know, those of us who did that to excess would benefit from that. But I said during that discussion we talked about being active early in life has that positive effect on life expectancy and living well in our later years. And to follow on from my colleague's previous discussion there, we have a health inequality in our society that has yet to be tackled, in my view, in the whole 7 years I've been in here. I've talked about the obesity crisis, smoking and alcohol, our mental health crisis, MSK conditions, type 2 diabetes and preventable gender, like 40% of cancers. And a lot of that is again, on the discussion today. We tackle that, I think, we tackle that in two ways. We can either decide that we're going to shovel more and more of our resource into treatment of these conditions, or we bite the bullet and we start to look at how we long-term look at how we prevent these conditions in the first place, and we have less people seeking medical conditions. Of course, In a discussion like this, what I'm discussing here is the ability or the need for us to make our youngsters active so in 70 years' time they can live a long and an active life. And that's something that we struggle with in as parliamentarians, to look further than 5 years. And I'm talking about 6 or 7 decades worth, how we lay the groundwork for that. I think what we know now, the younger gen, if we do that now, it will take 4 or 5 years to see any benefit from that kind of policy, and decades to bear the full fruits for an elderly population living that long and active, healthy life in later life. So what we have to do is look at how we ensure, as Carl Mockin said, my biggest inequality is inequality of opportunity, and how we make sure that we encourage our preschoolers to be physically active, how we give that opportunity to them. So we can tackle that inequality of opportunity, so the outcomes in later life are much better than they currently are. And it should be noted here, I think it was said earlier, in some areas of Scotland, you are near the end of your life expectancy if you're 50. That's a disgrace. That's an utter disgrace in a country like ours. So, as I said, it wasn't my intention to speak, Deputy Presiding Officer, but in conclusion, looking at how we live well in later life, I think what we have to do is look how we encourage our youngsters to live well. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. And I now call on the Minister, Jenny Minto, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Alexander Stewart for raising the motion for this debate. As I am, like I think most of my colleagues here, included in the age range, and like Brian Whittle, was slightly taken aback that it was 50s. And Christine Graham's comment about joining this parliament in your 50s as well, I recognise that as well. So I've listened very carefully to the contributions, and I'd like to thank everyone for engaging in this very important debate.
I too welcome the data which the University of Stirling-led Healthy Ageing in Scotland Haggis study provides on Scotland's 50-plus population. And as Alexander Stewart mentioned, the Scottish population is ageing. In 2020, there was an estimated 1 million Scotland residents aged 65 years or older, and by 2040, this will raise to an estimated 1.4 million. So it's clear that Scotland must adapt to our increasingly older population and ensure that all older people are afforded the opportunity to age well and be resilient. Now, I'd just like to confirm that my colleague, Ms Emma Roddick, has clear responsibilities for diversity, inclusion and equalities, including older people. And the Scottish Government want to make sure that all our policies on ageing are informed by evidence, and we regularly review the evidence available. For example, the Scottish Government is currently co-designing GURFI, or Getting It Right for Everyone. This will form the future practice model of all health and social care professionals and shape the future design and delivery of services, including those for older people and frailty. The Scottish Government consulted on a health and social care strategy for older people in 2022. And the Government also recognises that older people are significantly likelier than any other age groups to be living with dementia or unpaid carer for someone living with dementia. In March, I was pleased to attend the Introduction to Dementia Meeting Centres event, where I learnt about the work they are doing to support and give confidence to those with dementia and their families. I made the mistake of saying dementia sufferers. We need to change our outlook on dementia and the words we use about people living with dementia. In my previous life, and this touches a bit, I think, on what Rachel Hamilton was talking about, what we can learn from different communities. In my previous life, managing the Museum of Isle of Life in my constituency, one of my strongest memories is the additional stories and information that I got about exhibits and photographs from the older members of the island's community, some who had dementia and some not. I could see the positive impact to them contributing to the recording of Isla's social history. Both my grands lived with dementia, so I'm very pleased that the Scottish Government is currently developing a new dementia strategy for Scotland, which will reflect on the challenges facing these communities, as well as building on the supports that matter to them. The Parliament welcomed efforts to develop this strategy and core participation of people with lived experience in its development during last month's parliamentary debate on the topic, and I look forward to the Scottish Government publishing this strategy at the end of May. And through our new palliative and end-of-life care strategy, we are prioritising work on anticipatory care plans and looking at what can be done to promote their use. By enabling people to have conversations with health and care professionals about what matters to them, even when their health changes or deteriorates, and being able to record and share those conversations as a plan so the care and support they subsequently receive honours that plan. Now, care homes are where people live. And Christine Graham talked about the importance of recognising that. And they call these places home. And so they should therefore expect the same level of involvement, choice and support for their health and well-being as they would if they were living elsewhere in the community. But we also need to recognise that the demographics of people living in care homes have changed, having changed over the past 10 to 15 years. The needs of those who reside there are evolving too. Many people are living with increasingly complex health and care needs, and My Health, My Care, My Home is a blueprint for improvement in care homes and makes a series of recommendations to reduce the inequalities around access to wraparound care and provides direction and a vision to provide high-quality personalised care that is proactive, consistent, safe and meaningful. We have unfortunately seen social isolation and loneliness being made worse by the cost of living crisis. And as part of our emergency response to the cost crisis earlier this year, the Scottish Government invested £971,000 providing support to community organisations working to tackle social isolation and loneliness. And on the 8th of March this year, the £3.8 million Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund was launched and will run up to July 2026. This new Scottish Government funding will provide significant longer-term support for organisations and projects working on the ground to tackle socialisation and loneliness in our communities across Scotland, which Carol Mochan highlighted as well. Over the past 2 years since 2021, we provided £36 million through the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund to support the mental health and wellbeing of individuals, particularly those who are at most risk, including older people. Funding projects like the project in Postle Park, the Concrete Garden, which provides a space where people can meet, eat, learn new skills and garden. Local projects like this, which are focused on local solutions, supporting local communities, are key to help people's well-being and reduce social isolation. It, however, remains a sad reality that health, quality of life and even life expectancy, which Angus Stewart raised, can vary significantly amongst communities across Scotland. These inequalities are driven by differences in income, wealth and power. By addressing these, we can make Scotland a healthier and fairer place to live. This is why our public health initiatives are complemented by wide-ranging action to reduce poverty and mitigate the impact of the rise in the cost of living. In a country as energy-rich as Scotland, we should not have people living in fuel poverty. But with the UK government rolling back its already inadequate response to the energy cost crisis, we know many people will be struggling to keep their homes warm. Despite key policy levers like the regulation of energy markets remaining under the UK government's control, we are doing everything in our power to help those worst affected. Most recently, the First Minister announced increased support for households with energy costs, with up to £30 million available through the Fuel Insecurity Fund, a tripling of the fund from this time last year. And with this additional funding, we will be able to help further help thousands more people to stay warm in their homes. We want to make sure that all our policies on ageing are informed by evidence, and as I said before, we regularly review that evidence. I hope that this sets out the Scottish Government's commitment to older people and to healthy and dignified ageing, and show that the Scottish Government believe that older people are a valued and respected part of our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.